My name is Alice. And I remember everything.
Hi, and welcome back to Real Queer. My name is Cade, and today we are talking the Resident Evil franchise. And yes, that did sound more like Anna Faris in the House Bunny than it did the guy that does the Resident Evil menus.
Lily.
Now, if you're not familiar with Resident Evil, it started all the way back in 1996 as a video game called Biohazard. It featured characters like Jill Valentine and Chris Redfield as they explored the Spencer Mansion. And then later on, we got several sequels, several spin-offs, and the first game that I played myself was Resident Evil 5. I stayed up all night trying to beat that game before I had to return the rental. And if you don't remember renting video games, then you're not the same age as I am. Later on in life, I did play the rest of the franchise, so I've played the first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, the eighth. I've played the eighth multiple times. I played the remake of Resident Evil 3 and beat it within an hour and a half, and that's the biggest crime of that game. Resident Evil 2 is super fun, especially playing with, you know, infinite ammo. I've played some of the spin-offs, like Revelations. I think that's the only spin-off that I've played. But yes, Resident Evil has been like a major part of my life. It's been around since I was a kid, so it's kind of hard to avoid at this point, especially if you're a fan of the horror genre. Later on in the games, they did become more like the movies where they're more action-packed than they are, you know, horror, but they were still fun to play. And I think that this whole story regarding like a T virus, a G virus, a zombie apocalypse, and all these mutations has always been super fascinating. And I think that's what brings me back to the franchise each time. The storytelling within the games, you know, you have that long drawn out story and it's perfectly suited for video games, but not necessarily for movies. And that's when we will get into the CG Resident Evil films. I will be ranking the main franchise and the reboot, not including the CG films. I'll just give you like a quick breakdown of what I thought, because I did ask on Instagram if I should include them in my ranking and people said yes. So I regret doing that. Now, if you're new to my channel, I do recommendations as well as rankings like I'm doing today. I always do from worst to best, and if you're interested in those sort of videos, feel free to subscribe to my channel. Comment below and let me know what your favorite video game was from this franchise or your favorite movies. But without further ado, let's get into it. So with the CG films, as I mentioned, I asked on my Instagram story, should I add these to my rankings? People said yes, so I watched them, and as I also mentioned, I regret that. I would honestly rather sit through 10 viewings of Citizen Kane than sit through these CG films. Of course, it's interesting to see characters from the video games and what they're doing in between those video games, but the, you know, storytelling within the movies is kind of boring. There's more of a chance to tell those in the video games because they're so long and they have the time to do it. But with these movies, they always start out super boring, and there's some action toward the latter part of these films that make it interesting. But by that point, it's kind of, you know, why bother? So with the CG films, there's degeneration, which is kind of done before. You've seen the zombie apocalypse, you know what to expect from Resident Evil, and so it doesn't feel like anything fresh or new. There's damnation, which I guess you could say the same of, and when you get toward the 50-minute mark, there's just all these fun action pieces, which doesn't necessarily make the movie worth it, but it's nice to see. So if you decide to turn that on, just skip to the end. Then there's Vendetta. Vendetta I tried watching earlier, and I just could not get into it. It was super boring to me. I skipped to the end thinking, oh, let's watch what happens. How does it end? Is there going to be like a cool action scene? I was like, no, okay, I'm turning this off. So I tried to watch the Netflix series Resident Evil Infinite Darkness, and that would have been more palatable because you have the option of, you know, binging or watching 24-minute segments of this, but I couldn't subject myself to another CG Resident Evil property that was not a video game. It's not fun watching. It's like having the cutscenes but not being able to play along with it. Speaking of Netflix, there is a new Resident Evil series starting July 14th, and I am so looking forward to that, especially since they're bringing the Tyrant, the giant spiders, the lickers, the zombies, the dogs. Like, it looks like everything that I need from a live-action Resident Evil property. So the first and worst on my list is 2004's Resident Evil Apocalypse. Alice wakes up in the Raccoon City Hospital after the area has been overrun by zombies and must now make it out of the city before a nuclear bomb is dropped. So Resident Evil Apocalypse is super boring. It introduces characters from the video game like Carlos, the Stars, Jill Valentine, and Nemesis. Nemesis is super boring in this movie, and that's not like his character in the video games. You're always like threatened by his presence, and he's just like this nightmare fuel. In the movies though, he's just like a super boring guy walking around in prosthetics. With that said though, Nemesis does look really good in the movie, and I don't know, he's just kind of like a wasted character like most of the video game characters that are introduced in the movies. And this movie altogether is pretty inconsequential to the franchise. And that could be said about the next movie on my list, but it's super inconsequential. Like, it doesn't even matter. It introduces these characters and hardly really brings them back. Carlos is in the third movie and he kind of has like this love affair with Alice. They're super interested, but you know, the shit happens. And then Jill is brought back in later installments, but her character is wasted as well. But that's how I've said it 8 times, inconsequential that this movie is to the rest of the franchise. It introduces these elements that don't really matter going forward. It's poorly directed, it looks awful, and I just never remember it when I get back to it. That said, Resident Evil always has something interesting going for it, so this time around, I think the most standout moment in the film is when Alice bursts through some church windows and hits a licker with her motorcycle. It's like a very engaging scene and very commanding of Alice to do. Like, big dick energy from Alice.
Move!
Next on my list, we have 2012's Resident Evil Retribution. Alice fights alongside a resistance movement to regain her freedom from an Umbrella Corporation testing facility. Yes, the plot summary is as paper-thin as the storyline of the film. Resident Evil Retribution has very little bearing on the overall story of the franchise, and honestly, it could be completely avoided when sitting down to watch the rest of these movies. I would say that this installment is basically the Morbius to the Resident Evil franchise. Like, when you think of Marvel and how those movies are all pretty good, which I know Morbius isn't a part of the Marvel cinematic universe, but when you think of Marvel these days and how high budget and like the spectacle behind them is, it's the Morbius of the Resident Evil franchise. I don't know what else to tell you. Unfortunately, they wasted the return of all of these characters from previous entries. They quickly dispatched them all, and it's like, you had such power, Paul Wes Anderson. Why would you do this? It's so frustrating. It's basically like Scream 5. It's a legacy sequel. You get to see the return of all these characters, but it doesn't even really matter. I think the absurdity is what makes this installment super fun to watch, especially since it's just like a super polished, like high glossy VFX reel. It's like a super expensive music video. The storyline though, it doesn't even really matter come the final chapter, and that's not even touching like the great disaster that is Leon and Ada. Their characters are there to serve Alice to, you know, further develop her story and get her to the end of the movie, and then they're just completely wasted come the final chapter. I think waiting years between these movies, you get an idea of what to expect, and the end of the movie or the prior installment always gives you an idea of what to expect in the next movie, and most of the time that doesn't even happen, which is such a disaster. I was super excited for this installment, especially since it was in 3D and it, from the trailers, looked super cool. And then you sit down to watch it and you're like, what? How did this happen? But the standout moment in Resident Evil Retribution, I would say, is the laser tunnel. Of course, the laser tunnel is introduced in a lot of these installments, but it was just super cool to watch. It was bright, it was well lit, it's a white, like, long tunnel, and Alice is being chased by zombies, and it's just a super fun action piece. And I think watching Alice do her thing in these like skin tight leather get-ups is always so fun, not in like a sexual way, but like in a drag race way, you know, like you are waiting for the next look each movie, and it's like watching Drag Race and watching a queen come down the runway with this super extravagant, like, outfit. I don't know. That's how I feel watching Alice in each movie. She has a different design, and Mila Jovovich always brings, like, the best costumes. I will say that the Resident Evil franchise has always been near and dear to my heart, and I really like all of these movies. I basically watch them every year. You could ask anyone, they're probably sick of me talking about these just as much as they're sick of listening me talk about Jennifer's body. So I don't know, I just really like these. And these last few movies that are on my list, they're not perfect by any means, but I just really enjoy them. And the next one is 2010's Resident Evil Afterlife. While still out to destroy the evil Umbrella Corporation, Alice joins a group of survivors living in a prison who also want to relocate to the mysterious but supposedly unharmed safe haven known as Arcadia. Now, this is where the horror elements start to recede and the sci-fi action is the more favored subgenre. And I think that Afterlife is a super fun movie. It introduces more characters from the video game, but you also get introduced to the Las Plagas virus and you have the Axeman. The Axeman, of course, is kind of like that daunting force, like Nemesis or the Tyrant, this giant monster like barreling toward you, but this time he has a fucking axe. Now, with Resident Evil Afterlife, it's kind of like Retribution and Apocalypse in terms of not having like much to do with the overall story. Really, you could watch the first 20 minutes of this film and go straight to the final chapter and you would not have missed anything. I think that it is super cool that they filmed this movie in 3D and they filmed it with the same cameras that James Cameron used for Avatar. I think that adds like this super polish to it and makes it seem like it's more high budget, even though you could tell they're on a sound stage and it's just like a super glossy B-horror film. But Afterlife is kind of like that absurd point in the franchise where it's just there to turn off your brain and enjoy. But of course, like many other entries, we're introduced to Chris Redfield, who of course is in the video games, kind of like this main protagonist that a lot of people love in more ways than one. So Chris Redfield is played by Wentworth Miller. If you've seen Prison Break, you know who this is. He's also in Legends of Tomorrow, and he's got this completely annoying way of acting where it's all like, I see you have a zombie friend there. Like, it's this super annoying voice. But I give him a pass because he's gay and it's Pride Month.
Be who you are for your pride.
So Chris Redfield in this movie is a perfect adaptation of Chris Redfield. The standout moment in Afterlife for me is always going to be the battle between Claire and the Axeman in the showers inside the prison, because it's just a super slow motion action piece and it's fun to watch, especially when she gets the shotgun that has the quarters and blows his head up. It doesn't completely blow his head up, but it's always super fun visually watching that scene. Next on my list, we have 2021's Resident Evil Welcome to Raccoon City. Once the booming home of pharmaceutical giant Umbrella Corporation, Raccoon City is now a dying Midwestern town. The company's exodus left the city a wasteland with great evil brewing below the surface. When that evil is unleashed, the townspeople are forever changed, and a small group of survivors must work together to uncover the truth behind Umbrella and make it through the night. Resident Evil Welcome to Raccoon City. The first time that I had seen this movie, I was super hungover because we had a fun night the night before, and I was just not in the mood. I was kind of devastated that this, you know, movie was made, because Resident Evil, the final chapter, didn't even get time to breathe. They started developing this movie when Resident Evil, the final chapter, was being released in theaters, and originally, James Wan, I guess, was interested in adapting the video games, but of course it went over to this other director who directed 47 Meters Down and The Strangers Pray at Night, both movies that I don't think are terrible, but this time around it just seemed like nobody had fun making a Resident Evil movie, and they adapted the storylines from the first and the second and combined those, and I think that was a mistake, because the first storyline and the second, they would have been interesting to watch on their own, and you've got all of the characters from the video game being mashed into one setting, and it was disappointing to me, especially because it's 2021 and it is fueled by terrible CGI. I was really disappointed. This time around, I didn't mind it as much. I thought that it was an okay movie. It developed storylines from the first two, and it has these characters who aren't wasted like they were in the main franchise. So that was interesting to see. But I still feel like the story could have been the first game, and then a sequel could have been the second game, and it would have been a lot more interesting to watch, and these characters would have been able to develop more beautifully than they ever have been on the big screen. I will say that when it comes to Resident Evil Welcome to Raccoon City, there's not really a standout moment to me. I think that Lisa Trevor is kind of creepy, but as far as like the visuals go for the creatures, they're all underserved by the abysmal CGI, and in 2021 you expect CGI to still look like CGI but not be as awful as it is. And if you were to ask me, do I want a sequel to this movie, the answer is no. This movie could stand by itself and be fine. It ends abruptly, and I wouldn't care to see any of them come back. I think that Robbie Amell is of course a good-looking guy, and did he add much to Chris Redfield? I wouldn't mind seeing him as Chris Redfield again. And then the guy who played Wesker without a shirt on in that mid-credit scene, okay, I could watch that again. Next up, we have 2017's Resident Evil The Final Chapter. Alice returns to where the nightmare began, the Hive in Raccoon City, where the Umbrella Corporation is gathering its forces for a final strike against the only remaining survivors of the apocalypse. So Resident Evil, the final chapter, I have like a not so good relationship with. I was super excited because, as I've mentioned, I am a big fan of the Resident Evil movies. They're just near to me, and I just really like them. But with Resident Evil, the final chapter, I'd seen the third, the fourth, the fifth. I was getting ready to see the sixth in theaters. I sat my ass down in those chairs and I was comfy and I was like, let's do this. And then by the time it ended, I was super disappointed. Now, there's some travesties that happen on, you know, the set of this film, and you'll just have to research that. It is unfortunate, and it seems like a lot was happening. So this was an installment that you could tell that people probably weren't too happy to make, but they made it anyway. I think that the biggest flaw with this entry is that you were kind of spoiled in the fourth and the fifth one with all this, like, spectacle when it had come to the action scenes, and the editing in this movie is so abysmal, and I wish Sony would be like, let's put the time and resources into this to re-edit it and fire this guy, because the person that edited this movie, I have no excuse for them. Were you on meth? What happened? God, it was so bad. It was like, I don't know. I can't even describe it. You know, be spoiled by the action sequences in the prior two films and then not even really being able to see any action as it happened because there were so many quick cuts to a different angle. Like, ugh, so frustrating. And then to completely write off the battle that we would have seen at the White House is super, super irritating, because I wanted to see that. I had waited years to see that happen, and then it didn't. It was just, oh, Wesker betrayed us all and everybody died. Sorry. What?
What the fuck is going on in here on this day?
And then you get to this installment and you just... But that's kind of like the underlining factor of all of these Resident Evil movies, is that Paul Wes Anderson sets up these interesting stories or ends it with something that you'll look forward to in the next installment, and then years go by, you finally get that installment, and the, like, ending of each movie doesn't even have any bearing on the overall story. And for that to happen between Retribution and the final chapter, I think is the biggest missed opportunity. And I mentioned that in Retribution, you get these characters that return from prior films that are a part of the video games, and they're not, they should have been in this movie. This should have been like a legacy sequel. We're heading back to the Hive, to Raccoon City. You should have had all those characters brought back in this movie, especially since you're just introducing all of these characters that have no reason of being there other than a body count. It's so disappointing. But I had an edible and I had a good time this time around. So I don't know. I think the most interesting, like, standout thing in this movie is Alice being attacked by that demon dragon. That's what everyone seems to be calling it online. And I don't know, I like that part. But other than that, there's no real standout. And for it to come to an end, finding out that Alice is a clone herself isn't the biggest surprise, but it's like this whole clone thing has worn out its welcome, and to undermine the character by saying that she's a clone, it kind of is a slap to the audience who has been writing it out with this protagonist for the last 20 years. Like, what? Are you kidding me? She's a clone? And don't even get me started on that predictive combat shit, because that was so stupid. Anyway, I've talked about this movie enough. I enjoyed it more this time around than I had previously, but the editing is what will always piss me off when I watch it. Now, at this point, you all know that I throw you for a loop. I don't go with the movie that is considered the best by everyone else. I always do something stupid where I put, like, one that a lot of people probably don't like as my number one, and this list is no exception. At number two, we have 2002's Resident Evil. A special military unit fights a powerful, out-of-control supercomputer and hundreds of scientists who have mutated into flesh-eating creatures after a laboratory accident. So this is the original. This is the most suspenseful of the franchise. It's like the awakening I had, and it's just the movie that threw me into this entire franchise and made me love it as much as I do. I think the first time I watched it was on Stars, and I was just like floored by it because there were so many interesting aspects. There were zombies, there were these creatures that I just like couldn't get enough of, and it made me want to learn more about the Resident Evil mythology. And that's when I started watching people play the video games, because I wasn't much of a gamer myself, so if it wasn't Tony Hawk, I wasn't playing it. But the characters being the mutated like creatures that are in these movies were very interesting to me, and then being able to sit there and watch the movie with all of this action and suspense and the zombies and the liquors, and it was mind-boggling to my 9-year-old self. So yeah, I really like this movie. I think that it is essential to the franchise, and if you see one Resident Evil movie, it should be this one. You've got the iconic red dress, Michelle Rodriguez is there, and it's a good time. An action horror movie with Michelle Rodriguez, you already know that it's gonna be good. And I just really enjoy this movie. It's claustrophobic and it's good. It's a good time. For this movie, the standout scene will always be the laser tunnel. And I know that I've said the laser tunnel once before as the standout moment, but this one brings it. Like, there's people being chopped up, diced up. It's a really good time. And I think when people think of Resident Evil, this is the scene that they think of.
Ah! Shit. Got it.
Next on my list, we have 2007's Resident Evil Extinction. Survivors of the Raccoon City catastrophe travel across the Nevada desert, hoping to make it to Alaska. Alice joins the caravan and their fight against the evil Umbrella Corporation. This is my favorite of the franchise, based simply on the fact that it is the perfect combination of what had come before it and what will come after it. It has those horror elements, and this one I feel is actually scary, which is dumb to say because the CGI and the effects in it aren't that great. But this director, who was not Paul Wes Anderson, I think handled the horror elements very well. everything outside of that, probably not as much. But the main focus being horror, and what it delivers in this installment is just, it's great to me. I think it's creepy. I think that it's action-packed. So as I mentioned, it's just that perfect bonding of what makes this franchise, both sci-fi action and horror. And I really enjoy the horror aspect of Resident Evil Extinction. There are so many different things that stand out in my mind when it comes to Resident Evil Extinction, like the fire. That's definitely the standout moment. Alice controlling the fire, like shielding it, saving all these people who are part of the caravan. And I don't know, I just like that visually. I think that going back to that setting of the mansion is really interesting, and the clones being introduced here is interesting as well, because there's a promise like fight that you get in Afterlife where they're all invading this Resident Evil laboratory, and I like the setup to the next film, even if it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. But there are a lot of moving pieces within this installment that make it a lot more interesting than other installments in the franchise, and I really like the setting being in the desert, especially since I'm a desert boy myself. I grew up in Arizona, I lived in Vegas, so it was just like this giant thing that meshed well with my taste in movies, which everyone knows is shitty. But I love Resident Evil Extinction. Not to mention you have the introduction of Claire Redfield, who is kind of like a mainstay of this franchise when it comes to the video game characters that were brought over to it. And while her character doesn't have like a full arc herself, it is always nice to see her there. And as I mentioned, the standout moment in this movie is always going to be that fire scene where Alice is using her telekinetic powers or whatever the hell they are, because you don't get much further exploration of those powers. I guess you get an introduction of those in Apocalypse, and then they're taken away from her in Afterlife. So, and then they're given back to her, but then they're not given back. This franchise is very confusing as a whole. But I go back and I watch it every year or two, and I enjoy doing it. I find new things to like about it. This time I found out it was really bad, but I still liked it. The CGI in 4K is god awful. And I think that Resident Evil The Final Chapter is the best looking movie in this franchise. And I think Resident Evil Extinction is the best part. I think Apocalypse has some interesting things going for it, even though it is the worst. I'll always have a special place for this franchise in my heart, for Mila Jovovich. Like, even Paul Wes Anderson, he may not make the best movies or be the best writer, but when it came to this franchise, he was like the master of it. So I don't know, I give him props for that. The two times that they had a new director, it just didn't match the overall theme that the rest of the franchise does, which is that sci-fi action element. But it was nice for the third to be more of a creepy installment. Anyway, I feel like I'm getting to the point where I am going off subject, or I don't know what the hell I'm talking about, so I feel like it's a proper time to end this video. I personally think that you could watch the first film, Extinction, the first 20 minutes of Afterlife, and then jump right into the final chapter without really missing a beat to the story. The other ones are kind of all just filler, or they're just fun to throw on in the background and have some noise. So yeah, what are your favorite Resident Evil movies? Do you like the games? If so, what is your favorite game? I will see you guys in 2 weeks, where I have a video where I talk about my favorite queer characters, because it's Pride Month and I have to celebrate somehow. I do have a video recommending queer horror films from last year, so feel free to go back and watch that. You can follow me on letterboxd.kaidarade, on Instagram at real.queer or Mr. of the Dark, and I will see you guys next time. Thanks for watching.
You're all going to die down here.
You bitch. You dropped my baby.